Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Human Resource Management, A Very Short Introduction, by Adrian Wilkinson, narrated by Christine Rendel. Chapter 1. What is Human Resource Management, and why does it matter? While there is no universally accepted definition of human resource management, HRM, in simple terms, it is about the relationship between employer and employee and how this is managed. It covers all aspects of how people are managed, including working conditions, and how decisions about work are made when we go to work for someone, or we employ someone to work for us. It is worth noting that the average employee will spend 80,000 hours of his or her life at work. That equates to more time than we are likely to spend on any other activity during our lifetimes. We spend more time with our work colleagues than many of us spend with our families. The management of our working lives is therefore a topic that affects nearly all of us and has important ramifications for society as a whole. Recent work by Bryson and McCarran found that paid work is ranked lower than 39 other common activities people engage in, except for being sick in bed. Well-being at work varies depending on where you work, at home, in an office, or elsewhere. Whether you combine work with other activities, whether you work with others, when you work, and your personal and household characteristics. Some of this can be influenced by the choices we make for ourselves and the decisions made for us by others, managers, as well as public policy that governs the working environment. If we are not, as individuals, complete masters of our destiny, we do have choices as a society. Human Resource Management, HRM, is about the management of people in the context of an employment relationship. In short, if we are working for someone and getting paid, compensated, we are in an employment relationship. For some, work is a daily grind, but not everyone views work in a negative sense. People can enjoy the work itself, or they might enjoy the contribution they can make. They might enjoy being part of a community in the workplace. People who win the lottery, for instance, will often continue to work when they have no need of the paycheck. There are no simple scientific laws, although there are employment laws, to apply in HRM, and much, therefore, depends on context. However, people differ not only from each other, but in their attitudes and reactions from one day to the next. This is what makes HRM a source of both fascination and frustration. The term herding cats comes to mind. Thus, it is hard to make predictions in the same way as you can in, say, physics. Managing people in a large manufacturing firm is different from running a corner store. Working at a merchant bank is different from working on the docks or at a hospital. Equally, how HRM is managed will vary across cultures and countries. The USA is rather more individualistic than, say, mainland Europe, where things tend to be viewed in more social and collectivist terms. Equally, in Japan, age, family, and respect for honour are central. This has implications for HRM. If there is a view that individual motivation and capability is the key to success, practices may well be configured to facilitate this. If there is more emphasis on collective routes to achieve tasks, then again, practices may be configured to allow for that. Legislative and other forms of regulation vary considerably across countries, as do institutional arrangements, law, rules, custom, and practice. In the US, a hire and fire at will philosophy means staff can be treated differently from those in, for example, Germany, where laws and regulations mean making workers redundant or dismissing them for other reasons is a slower and more considered process. Here, we can see the ingredients for misunderstandings when multinational corporations take their assumptions and institutions to another part of the world on the basis of best practice. Differing institutional contexts also help explain variation in the prevalence of zero-hours contracts or the conditions of the gig economy. When did HRM begin? The Industrial Revolution was the crucible for the creation of modern management. With the steam engine as the driver, new modes of thought accompanied the Industrial Revolution. Indeed, if we were to look to the most revolutionary change that drove the Industrial Revolution, it is a transformation in transport. First associated with Britain's canal systems, then steamships and trains, ease of transport allowed for a concentration of people and resources, while at the same time exposing previously sheltered industries to competition and innovation. As there were no business schools or colleges given over to the training of managers, most firms initially recruited managers internally, either through the delegation of family members or by promoting workers from the shop floor. Firms slowly realized, however, that although technical knowledge was a useful attribute in running a business, it was not as important as general managerial ability, a capacity to identify operational problems, recruit and motivate staff, match supply with demand, and keep an eye on the innovations implemented by competitors. The British historian Sidney Pollard notes that Britain's coal industry was the largest supplier of managers to Britain's expanding factories and mills. Not only was this industry the first to use steam power with the introduction of the Newcomen engine, the world's first atmospheric steam engine, in 1712, the workforces were also far larger than those found elsewhere, the typical coal mine employing hundreds of workers at a time when most workshops engaged a handful. Organisations grew simply too large to be properly controlled by their owners, so managers became responsible for the organisation. That is not to say everything was new. It has been pointed out that good parts of the management armoury were available prior to the Industrial Revolution, given most organisations have to deal with issues of coordination and control. And the functions, ideologies, practices, and theories of management have changed over time since the foundation of modern management. But the concepts and applications of management have now become so pervasive in our society that they are prevalent not only in for-profit firms, but also in non-profits, cooperatives, state agencies, and any aspect of society that requires organisation. Although people worked in pre-industrial times, it was the Industrial Revolution that led to greater formalisation and the creation of a factory regime. This created manager and worker relationships, with the employer providing tools and equipment and paying for work. Such pay was used to obtain the things workers needed to live, food, shelter, etc., rather than them working the land on which they lived. Equally, their previous relationship with landowners, which was more personal, which is not to say it was not exploitive, was replaced by more impersonal relations between employer and employee, with supervisors who were not owners, but the beginning of a professional cadre who later became management. The supervisor hired and fired, as well as organized and instructed work. With the first factories, the dark, satanic mills described by the English poet William Blake, came systems. As production moved to a larger scale, masters built factories and installed machinery to take advantage of market and technological opportunities. They also needed a new sort of labour, one that was more disciplined and literate than those of the pre-industrial order. It made little difference when individual workers started work, when each operated their own hand tools. However, when mechanized production was introduced, it required all to work to the same exact schedule. Initially, mechanization was solely restricted to the spinning of cotton and, to a lesser degree, wool. With increased competition, the employers also brought hand weavers into the mills and sought to improve the quality of production through increased supervision. Although the early factories did employ large numbers of children sourced from orphanages and poorhouses, this proved a brief stage in the production process, as with higher levels of capitalization, employers sought higher productivity through literate and more skilled workforces, and children were inefficient and hard to train. This coincided with laws forbidding child labour driven by humanitarian concerns. And by 1851, most children no longer worked in factories. As productivity soared, wholesale and retail prices collapsed. By 1860, a metre of cloth could be purchased for 13% of its 1790 price. Not only did this make clothing far cheaper, it also forced constant innovation to compensate for falling prices. The factory owners also needed to think in a rather different and more systematic way in terms of recruiting and rewarding workers. But factories in these times were not how we would recognize them today, at least not in Western industrialized countries. They were messy, noisy, chaotic, and dangerous. The factory regime created enormous social problems, both in and outside the factory, and living conditions were dismal. So the labour problem had a knock-on effect and created broader social problems. In Elizabeth Gaskell's novel, North and South, set in the fictional industrial town of Milton, Manchester, we see the heroine witness grim working and living conditions. The factory clock governed life. After all, time is now seen as money, rather than the seasons or the weather, moulding the culture of capitalism. Indeed, the economic historian David Landers argued that timepieces, even more than the steamship, drove the economic development of the West, as factory owners gave watches to punctual workers, and workers brought their own timepieces to work so that they did not need to trust the factory clock. This explains the tradition in some cultures of being given a watch upon retirement, as your time was now your own. In all this, we see the emerging roots of HRM. The early campaigns for worker welfare in the 18th and 19th centuries were driven by a mix of humanitarian, religious, philanthropic, and business motives. Work began to be regulated with restrictions on children working in factories and then on working hours. Some employers took innovative approaches, such as Robert Owen, the Welsh philanthropist and social reformer, who established New Lanark near Glasgow, a spinning mill village with housing for workers and schools for children based on paternalistic principles, and setting out a goal of an 8-hour workday with the slogan, 8 hours of labour, 8 hours recreation, 8 hours rest. The Cadbury family, Quaker industrialists, built Bourneville Village just outside Birmingham in the 1890s to locate their cocoa and chocolate factory for their workers, who were provided with good wages and working conditions. Cadbury's also introduced works committees and pensions, as well as making provisions for parks and medical services. Organisations increasingly began to offer workplace amenities, such as medical care, housing, and libraries. At the same time, functionaries and departments specialising in HR processes, such as hiring, payroll, and record keeping, emerged. But if we can detect the growing shoots of management in earlier times, most people see Frederick Winslow Taylor, an American engineer and consultant, as the founder of modern management in the early 20th century. Taylor developed the idea of scientific management and argued that efficiency in business could be achieved through observing scientific principles and close monitoring. Science was to be applied to a fair day's work. Managers took responsibility by replacing rule-of-thumb systems of craft workers and reduced these to rules, laws, and formulas, allowing for less skilled workers to replace craft workers. Managers would instruct workers on what to do, how to do it, and how much time to take to do it. In short, managers did the thinking, and workers carried out the orders. Henry Ford, the American industrialist, adopted these principles in the context of mass production and assembly lines to build cars. The system did run into problems of motivation and morale. A huge machine works at Pittsburgh in the USA in 1906 needed to hire 12,000 men and women to fill 10,000 jobs, as they needed to factor in the hemorrhaging of staff. Years later, this was also the experience in Italian car factories, with many more people employed than could work there if they all turned up. The tyranny of machines and the factory system governing the lives of workers featured in Charlie Chaplin's famous film, Modern Times, which satirises the factory process as developed by Henry Ford in the 1920s, with his factory worker running around trying to tighten screws wherever he went, failing to keep up, and eventually being sucked into the machine. While Taylor tended to ignore the human factor in efficiency, the newly emerging discipline of personnel management embraced it. The same period saw a shift from direct systems of management, personal supervision, traditional paternalism, and simple piecework systems, to more complex technical systems of management and bureaucratic forms of employment. The human relations school sought to put workers more into the foreground of management systems and to see them as not just necessary cogs in the machinery of work, but as people with broader needs and interests. HRM pioneers, drawing from writers like Mary Follett, an American thinker and political philosopher at the turn of the 20th century, began to lay out the principles of modern personnel methods with progressive changes in management style so as to humanise the workplace. A bigger impetus to HRM was provided by the First World War, which increased the need for complex systems to recruit, train, and reward large numbers of workers. As organizations became larger and more complex, so HRM comes to the fore. We should note that the term HRM is used in different and confusing ways. It can mean three different things. First, it is an overall term to refer to managing people in organizations. In this sense, HRM is found wherever there is employment. Second, it is also used with regard to the specific function, the HRM department. Third, in the academic literature, it often refers to a new model approach to people management dating from the 1990s and the discovery of people as a strategic resource. The professional HRM function has often been criticized as fulfilling a large administrative function rather than contributing to strategic goals directly as management itself. All large organizations have HRM departments, often with specialists within them, responsible for dealing with recruitment, selection, training, talent management, performance management, reward, and employment relations. In smaller firms, these roles are often taken by one of the senior managers. But once the numbers rise and it becomes difficult to deal with people on an individual basis, an HRM function is usually established. In large multinational organizations, the function may be dealing with employees across the globe with all the complexity that entails. Traditionally, the HRM function was seen as much more about dealing with staffing problems rather than workforce optimization. This was the backdrop for the rise of the new model HRM in the mid-1980s, a model that promised to develop and utilize the potential of human resources in pursuit of the organization's strategic objectives, a promise that informed the work of management researchers and excited practitioners. Today, in an era of globalization, several factors have emerged that heighten the significance and complexity of HRM, including global sourcing, regional trade agreements, and labor standards, as well as cultural differences and innovation driven by competition. As traditional sources of competitive advantage evaporate, such as access to capital, protected markets, and proprietary technologies, firms are looking to how they manage employees to provide a competitive edge. This includes managing and improving skills, capabilities, and behaviors. In fact, the harsh reality is that people are more often seen as a cost to be minimized, particularly in tough times. Senior managers have more often tried to minimize the impact of employees on performance by substituting capital for labor where possible. That is, investing in technology and automating work, which reduces the need for staff, and designing bureaucratic organizations that place an emphasis on rule following rather than facilitating initiative and empowerment. It is fair to say that HRM rhetoric, "people are our most important asset," while often espoused by organizations, has often been regarded cynically at the employee level. The practice of HRM is often accorded low status in organizational strategies, and the traditional separation of those who manage from those who actually do the work persists, contrary to the HRM ideal of workers being empowered and using their talents. Workers are also skeptical, as they note the difference between their experience and the rhetoric. Nevertheless, we have seen something of a revolution taking place in many organizations today. Managers, whether they explicitly acknowledge a human resource focus or not, are now actively interested in getting staff more motivated, engaged, and committed so as to meet demands and deliver organizational returns. This has been especially true of the service sector, the growth of which has come parallel to the growth of HRM. HRM has been embraced as transformative in this domain, where from the perspective of customers, workers are the product, more than in manufacturing and design firms, where creativity in pursuit of product and systems innovations and efficiencies are seen as critical. Whether in the laboratory of university HRM departments or in the gritty reality of the factory floor, there is no single model of HRM to be applied. Indeed, the discipline has stretched to accommodate horizons beyond the traditional tailorist focal point of large-scale manufacturing. The subject of HRM covers the small owner-managed textile sweatshops in Brick Lane, London, as well as the high-tech behemoths such as Apple, Facebook, and Google of Silicon Valley in California. Thus, HRM covers individual and collective relations, the whole range of HR practices and processes, line management activities, as well as those of HR specialists, and both managerial and non-managerial actors. The history and evolution of HRM emphasizes its long-standing concern with a human focus on employee well-being. As noted, this focus was much in evidence in early developments in the areas of occupational health and safety in the 19th century. But we now see this focus reflected in issues.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.